For more than half a decade, I've hosted a show about how my investigations into the arguments of creationism led to me learning real science. During the course of the show, I have had some rather heated debates with creationists about whether the creationist view is a better explanation than evolution. I've been told what evolution doesn't explain, and heard no end to the number of things explained by creationism. There is a lot to unpack here, though. When we're referring to creationism, we are discussing a range of different beliefs, from a literal six-day creation event 6,000 years ago, to the old Earth beliefs that range from a million-year-old to billions-of-year-old universe, all of them claiming to be consistent with their interpretation of Scripture, not to mention the rather significantly common mere belief that under it all there is a designer who used evolution to get us here. In summary, there isn't just one set of creationist beliefs. On the other hand, while virtually no one in science would actually use the word evolutionist to describe themselves, whenever the term is used, it is usually in reference to someone who accepts one, and not necessarily all, of the scientific models of common descent, abiogenesis, the Big Bang, and uniformitarian principles. Further, when we refer to an explanation being better than another, we run into issues. If neither explanation is observable, how can we determine the truth between them? What exactly makes one explanation better than another? Do we determine the value of an explanation by the sheer quantity of phenomena that it explains, or by what we can do with that explanation? What is truth anyway? Time to read between the lines. The strengths of the creationist position should be obvious. It explains everything, and it's very easy to understand. Obviously, there's a bit more you need to know to engage in a debate on the topic, but to be a normal person, living a regular life, doing typical things like raising a family and voting, you really don't need to know that much more. There probably will never be a dire situation in your life where you immediately need to defend your views against evolution. In fact, you can be extremely successful and happy in life without even considering evolution. This is compounded by the fact that evolution hasn't specifically explained some rather significant details about the world we live in, and the explanations we do have keep changing when new evidence is found. We can't explain what, if anything, caused the Big Bang, or even if the question makes sense. We can't explain how life started. Not only does evolution not explain everything, but you actually have to keep up with it just to know what the theory is. With creationism, there really is no mystery. From the moment the universe was spoken into existence, to the moment the breath of life entered Adam's lungs, to the geology we see all around us. The question of how everything got here can be easily explained by assuming it was all created by an intelligence supernaturally. There is literally nothing that can't be explained this way, as opposed to using methodological naturalism, which is limited by our own human limitations. The fact is, confining ourselves to naturalistic explanations means we have to accept the fact that we just can't explain everything at present, while opening your mind to the supernatural gives you all the explanations you need. When the naturalistic approach can't explain how a structure could evolve gradually, the supernatural approach will always be able to explain it. With this approach, nothing is impossible, but it necessarily follows from there that nothing is predictable, since we have no way of knowing if or when supernatural interference is likely to occur. The strength of evolution is not in how much it explains, but in its predictive power. It's easy to see evidence and then explain it, but it's a completely different thing to use that explanation to predict something that has never been seen before and then go out and find it. This is how you know your explanation is at least somewhat right. When we discuss scientific evidence for a theory, we're not claiming that any theory is ever proven. We're also not just discussing individual phenomena that are consistent with the theory. We're talking about the confirmation of scientific predictions made by the theory. By assuming particular tenets to be true, we can use the scientific method to predict the results of an experiment or observation before it's conducted. This is how new discoveries and real-world applications are made every day. These predictions, in turn, are presented in the form of a hypothesis. Very simply, it goes like this. If theory A is true, we should expect to see phenomenon B when we conduct experiment or observation C. The next obvious step is to conduct experiment or observation C and determine whether you see phenomenon B as theory A predicted. If you don't see phenomenon B as predicted, then your theory is wrong and needs to either be revised or discarded. If you do see phenomenon B as predicted, your theory still isn't proven, but it has been validated, and the cycle continues as the theory is used repeatedly to predict new discoveries and ultimately new applications for those discoveries. For example, the Big Bang model was first formulated in 1922 and 1924 by Alexander Friedman to little attention until rediscovered in 1927 by Georges Lemaître. Lemaître was a Catholic priest and scientist who proposed that at some point in the finite past, all of the matter and energy in the universe was much closer. In 1931, he built upon that by postulating that it had at one point perhaps even been condensed into what he called a primordial atom. Unfortunately, Alexander Friedman died in 1925, and so Lemaître's popularization of his model overshadowed him. In 1946, George Gamow published a paper on nucleosynthesis describing how radiation could recombine and become basic atoms after the Big Bang. He assumed that the majority of the early universe was radiation and theorized that in the process of recombination, microwaves would be released at a temperature of 50 Kelvin. In 1964, Robert H. Dick, Jim Peebles, and David Wilkinson at Princeton University were preparing to search for microwave radiation as a means of testing their own theory. They felt that the cosmic background radiation would have been released along with matter at the Big Bang and, due to billions of years of redshift, would now be everywhere, in every direction, at a temperature of under 5 Kelvin. At the same time, Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson were working at nearby Bell Labs experimenting on bouncing radio waves off of echo balloon satellites. After canceling out any potential radio sources, they continued hearing a low, steady, mysterious noise that persisted in their receiver. They soon found out that no matter where they pointed their receiver, the mysterious noise persisted. They had discovered microwave background radiation at a temperature of 2.7 Kelvin. This confirmed the hypothesis of Dick, Peebles, and Wilkinson. In 1978, Penzias and Wilson were jointly awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics for their discovery. This does not mean that the Big Bang necessarily happened, but it does mean it makes testable, real-world predictions. It also doesn't disprove creationism, as there are many creationists who accept the Big Bang as at least a viable model, if not a phenomenon consistent with the universe being spoken into existence by a supernatural intelligence in a burst of light. In fact, Georges Lemaître, as a Catholic priest, proposed the Big Bang as a confirmation of the Genesis account of creation. The predictive nature of the uniformitarian model originates in the mid to late 1700s, when James Hutton, a Scottish geologist, observed the slow geological processes around him and deduced that these processes, over time, could explain geological features around the world. Other geologists, such as Charles Lyell, built upon his model, holding that the present geological processes were the key to understanding the past. Among these processes was the slow movement of the continents around the globe, as explained by what would be called plate tectonics. In 1912, Alfred Wegener offered a predictive model of this concept in his German presentation, translated as "The Uprising of Large Features of Earth's Crust on a Geophysical Basis." Wegener demonstrated how geological features of each continent show a continuity when aligned accordingly. This arrangement also happened to correlate to the continuity of fossil finds. One way or another, the continental shelves aligned very well, as did their topography and paleontology. Based on Wegener's work, Swiss geologist Emil Argand reasoned that if the Himalayas, Pyrenees, and Alps were the result of continental collisions, then beneath them we should find salt domes and hydrocarbon deposits such as petroleum. This prediction, given in a 1922 conference in Brussels, followed a decade of predictions of this same phenomenon throughout the world. This is exactly what was discovered under the Himalayas, Pyrenees, and Alps. With the aid of seismic and gravitational measurement, these mountain chains are currently being tapped for their oil resources. This is both a confirmed prediction and a real-world application of uniformitarianism, but it does not prove uniformitarianism to be true. It also is not the only way to find oil. There are several other methods of finding oil. While there exists more than one flood model purporting to explain how oil deposits form, none of them have ever been used to predict where to find oil. This doesn't necessarily mean a worldwide flood didn't happen, but it does mean the worldwide flood model has no practical real-world applications. Using uniformitarian principles in conjunction with common descent, we can also predict specific fossils in very specific strata and in very specific locations before they are discovered. For example, the lobe-finned fish Eustenepteron was already known from 385 million-year-old strata. Ichthyostega was also known from 365 million year old strata. Based on these two discoveries, three paleontologists were able to predict that they should expect to find the fossil of an organism which appeared to have tetrapod wrist bones with rays instead of digits, spiracles in the head for a lung system, as well as a head extending from the body by a neck. They predicted that this combination of tetrapod and fish traits would be found stratigraphically between Ichthyostega and Eustanepteron on Ellesmere Island, Nunavut, in northern Canada. 5 years later, they found three individuals with those exact traits and named them Tiktaalik. This methodology is how scientists develop all of the proposed lineages you see on display. Using uniformitarianism and common descent together, they predict where to look stratigraphically as well as geographically for undiscovered fossils every day. The real-world application of common descent itself begins not with a prediction of evolution, but with a creationist prediction. By the early 1700s, it was obvious that there were far more living species on Earth than could fit on an ark, and even farmers were aware that the morphology of their own crops and livestock changed over time. Carolus Linnaeus, a Swedish botanist, decided to test the notion of a created kind by examining organisms and associating each species together based on their physical traits into genera, approximating biblical kinds. He was surprised that these different genera also shared common characteristics that unified them into larger groups of orders and then into classes, forming a nested hierarchy. Through this, he unified all animals into one kingdom and all plants into their own kingdom. Although Linnaeus failed to discover the biblical kinds, the result of this work gave naturalists a tool that made more sense of biology. Charles Darwin is famous for proposing in 1859 that the explanation for these nested hierarchies was that all life descended from the same ancestor, and proposed several future tests for this explanation. With the discovery of DNA, instead of classifying organisms by their physical features, the notion of comparing genetic sequences to test for relationship was put forward in 1958 by Francis Crick, who was one of the two credited discoverers of the DNA helix. In 1977, Carl Woese and George Fox published a paper doing exactly that by comparing the ribosomal RNA of various different species. This showed that all organisms they had examined were using genetically calculable variants of the same sequence, implying relationship. By 1984, the first genetic paternity test was performed, showing that DNA was effective in determining relationship verifiably, and to this day, we use this test to legally determine relationship between people. This is the same method used to determine relationship between species, constituting legal proof of common descent. The theory of common descent made a further prediction in the DNA regarding convergent evolution, which neither creationism nor Linnaean taxonomy could predict. A genetic indicator of relation is the continuity of genes. Hox genes are an example of this. The Hox genes that code for locations and proportions of the parts in your own body can be traced through every tetrapod, whether fish, amphibian, reptile, bird, or mammal, and even through crustaceans and insects. This was already observed. Contrary to this, if common descent were true, similar structures between two species that are not closely related should be coded for by different genes. And that is, in fact, what we see. The bill of a duck and the bill of a platypus are coded for by different genes. The gills in fish, some crustaceans, and some mollusks are all coded for by different genes. The list goes on. There is no reason to expect this from a common designer, nor from mere Linnaean taxonomy. This methodology, however, would prove to have life-saving applications. In 2013, there was a popular story in the media about Callie Hardig, a 12-year-old girl who was admitted to the hospital having contracted a brain-eating amoeba called Naegleria fowleri after suffering 2 days of headaches, nausea, persistent sleepiness, and eventually exhibiting facial paralysis on her right side. Infection of this sort had a 97% fatality rate, and only when diagnosed within 1 day of infection had any treatments been successful. Conventional treatment of amphotericin, fluconazole, and azithromycin was ineffective. The only option available was a hypothetical treatment of miltefacine, an already FDA-approved drug used to treat cancer and for its anti-tumor, anti-inflammatory activity. The development and approval of new drugs is a very expensive process. In medicine, it is not uncommon to look to already existing and already FDA-approved drugs as potential new treatments. In 1984, Bill Pendergast and Joseph Chan at the Wellcome Research Laboratories in Beckenham, England, discovered that this cancer medication was also effective against a single-celled organism called Leishmania, which is also responsible for a disease known as leishmaniasis, causing ulcers in the skin, nose, and throat, reducing red blood cells, and enlarging the spleen and liver. However, miltefacine became a common treatment for leishmaniasis. Using genetic barcoding in 2002, a team led by Julia Woloknik and Michael Duchesne determined a distant relationship between leishmania and isolated species of acanth amoeba. Based on these assumed relationships, a team led by Frederick Schuster and Govinda Visvesvara decided to test miltefacine efficacy by injecting it into several species with implied relationship to leishmania and acanth amoeba, including Naegleria fowleri. All cultures injected with miltefacine were effectively eradicated. Based on this confirmation of a prediction derived from an assumed distant relationship, the team proposed miltefacine as an effective treatment for Naegleria fowleri. In 2013, one day after being administered miltefacine, Callie Hardig's condition began improving. 55 days later, she was released from the hospital, and by 6 months later, all effects of the infection had vanished. Whether or not leishmania and fowleri are related, the assumption of common descent saved a young girl's life. Even the mechanisms of evolution, random mutation, and selection are used every day to design better electronics and mechanical systems through what are known as evolutionary algorithms. This method of design allows minuscule mutation and selection to test and predict the function and efficiency of random designs through repeated generations of a product. For example, in 2007, a team led by Pierre Legrand at the University of Bordeaux, France, developed an evolutionary algorithm to configure electrodes for cochlear implants. Legrand's team took just 1.5 days to configure an optimal pattern for one patient whose doctors had not succeeded in 10 years. The use of evolutionary algorithms is so effective that there are critics who argue that the technique may lead to designs that can't be properly evaluated, since no human understands which trade-offs were made and therefore where failure is likely. The hypothetical natural origin of life also has real-world applications that are saving lives. In the early part of the 20th century, both Alexander Oparin and Jonathan Haldane deduced that the chemical constituents to life could be synthesized from molecules common in Earth's early atmosphere: methane, ammonia, hydrogen, and water vapor. This was tested in the Miller-Urey experiment, which showed that these molecules do, in fact, form amino acids when they experience an electrical discharge. In the early 1950s, Sidney Fox began his own experiments, including generating proteinogenic amino acids from methane samples. By 1957, Fox and a team from Iowa State University hypothesized that amino acids and proteinoids would form vesicles under very normal conditions. To test this, the team boiled a sample of Fox's proteinoids in a saline solution for 30 minutes and allowed it all to cool. When observed microscopically, the proteinoids had arranged themselves into small spherical compartments superficially resembling a cell. These microspheres were able to form junctions with other microspheres and developed a double membrane corresponding to that of a cell. Fox then suggested microspheres as a potential vehicle for vaccinations. A problem with some vaccinations is the immune system itself. With certain treatments, the body destroys the active agent before it can reach its destination to have any effectiveness. Microspheres were proposed as a method of protecting the active agent until it reaches its intended target. A modified microsphere comprised of lipids is now the industry standard for vaccinations, including the COVID-19 vaccinations, which use a small snippet of messenger RNA coding for the required antibodies. Without microspheres protecting this sequence, the vaccine would have little or no effect. So there is no doubt that using the assumptions of common descent, abiogenesis, the Big Bang, and uniformitarian principles to predict what we see in nature has undoubtable and even life-saving applications in the real world. This does not mean that any of these models are true, but their applications do benefit you every day. This also doesn't mean that creationists can't be scientists. As cited by many creationists, Raymond Damadian, who is a creationist, invented the MRI. According to his 1971 paper, Tumor Detection by Nuclear Magnetic Resonance, development of the MRI began with investigating potassium ions inside cells. He observed that potassium had a fixed charge to counter ions, but he and other researchers found that the ions reacted differently in distilled water. Damadian predicted that cancerous cells would be detectable because of their elevated potassium levels. He suggested that these differences could be used to detect cancer even in the early stages where it would be most treatable and would provide a non-invasive way of detecting cancers and monitoring the effectiveness of therapies. Although Damadian was a creationist, at no point in this process was the assumption of a supernatural creation event used to develop the MRI. Louis Pasteur was a creationist and is credited with disproving a type of abiogenesis known as spontaneous generation. Up to then, spontaneous generation was touted as proof of God's creation by well-known creationists such as Saint Augustine and Archdeacon Gerald of Wales. Pasteur's experiment with flasks full of broth followed centuries of experiments by numerous others, showing that life doesn't just suddenly sprout into existence from dead material. At no point, however, was the assumption of a supernatural creation event tested to predict these results. The scientific method itself was in fact perfected by Francis Bacon, a creationist who was inspired by René Descartes' rationalism. In 1620, Bacon published Novum Organum, presenting the scientific method specifically to remove personal biases from scientific work, which he called idols of the mind. Chief among these idols of the mind was religion, which he saw as interfering with science. Many great scientists were true believers, yet no discovery from any of them has ever come about by testing any supernatural assertion. This doesn't mean that creationism is wrong, but it does mean that it cannot be called scientific. I have seen many apologists retroactively apply creationism as having use in designs. In one case, biomimetics was offered as an example of using God's design to influence human designs. One example cited was bird's wings used as the design for aircraft wings, suggesting that this design required the assumption of a designer to explain the complexity of the feather and its barbules as well as the genetics behind it. This fails because neither the barbules nor the genetics were known when the wing was designed, nor were either of them actually used in the design of an aircraft wing. Beside the absence of feathers in an airplane wing, it also doesn't serve the purpose of powering flight as a bird's wing does. Attempts to power human flight in the same way had unfortunate, often hilarious, but also tragic results. The design of an aircraft wing borrows the use of airflow to create lift, which extends the ability to glide, and, again, this was done simply by emulating what was seen. There was no assumption of a supernatural intelligent designer being tested. Only after it worked successfully did we hear that it would have been predicted by the assumption of an intelligent designer. Across the board, I have seen creationists cite several items that would be predicted by creationism but weren't until after the discovery. Some examples: creationists were not claiming that vestigial organs had function until after their functions were known. Creationists were not predicting marine fossils would be found on mountaintops until after they were discovered. And creationists were not predicting that non-coding DNA would be translated into messenger RNA, nor that such translation constitutes functional DNA until after it was discovered. These are often cited as evidence for creationism, but again, creationism did not predict them until after they were discovered. The real-world applications for evolution exist whether or not evolution is true, and they do not as yet exist for creationism, whether or not creationism is true. The key phrase there is whether or not it's true. In this video, I am not advocating for the truth of evolution. I am quite aware that everyone has their own idea of truth. What I've been advocating for is the practical applications of science that use these models, whether you believe in any of them or not, and whether or not they're true. They do enhance your life, usually for the better. But I am sincerely curious about where people draw the line in accepting science when it appears to come into conflict with their religious precepts. Wherever you fall on the creationist spectrum, I am interested in understanding why you would adamantly reject scientific models that have real-world application in favor of a particular interpretation of scripture that has thus far had no application at all. If you are an advocate for removing evolution from schools, I would also like to know why you would advocate for removing a scientific model that actually has saved lives from classrooms that may include future scientists. As I stated at the beginning, you are capable of living your entire life without even having to consider evolution, but there are people who do, and many of them are making your life better, so why prevent that? In that vein, Disciple Science is a creationist who also accepts the real-world evidence for evolution. He is open about his belief being faith-based, yet he accepts the real-world science for what it is.
One other assumption that impacts our interpretations is the belief that studying God's creation and studying the Bible could lead us to different conclusions. But while there is historical baggage tied up in that concern, we agree with St. Augustine of Hippo that all truth is God's truth. And if science reveals something to be true, we should also see it as a truth from God.
You can visit Disciple Science's channel by clicking on the link in the description below. On the other side of the spectrum, Dapper Dino is a channel that consistently addresses scientific misrepresentations made by creationists and goes into deep discussion about scientific evidence for evolution, but nowhere does he besmirch religious views.
So a platypus has a bill like a duck?
In fact, no. The platypus bill is nothing like a duck's, except in overall shape. In a duck, the majority of the upper bill is a centered premaxilla. with the maxilla only starting towards the posterior end of the upper jaw. And of course, it still has the basic tetrapod lower jaw, with a dentary, angular, serangular, and articular bone on each side, and an articular quadrate joint. Also, the covering of the bill is keratin, not skin.
You can also visit Dapper Dino's channel by clicking in the link in the description below. Too often in debates, we become antagonistic. First, we disagree and call each other stupid or fools. Later on, it isn't enough to call each other stupid, so we move on to villainizing each other. This is true whether we're discussing religion, science, politics, or any other passionately held perspectives. The point of this series is to attempt to get productive dialogues going on about science, philosophy, politics, ethics, and even current events. We don't have to agree, but we certainly don't have to villainize each other. I hope I'm not alone in that endeavor. References for all of my claims are in the description. Thank you for watching.